everyone, a very warm welcome to my class. This is in continuation to the summary analysis of the subject sociology of paper 1 and the unit 8, religion and society. Today's lesson, I'm going to explain to you all about Max Weber's theory of religion. This is the syllabus as prescribed by the UPSC. Going in for a recap, my previous lesson I explained to you all about Karl Marx's theory. The criticism that were meted out on Karl Marx's theory is what I explained to you all. Today I'm going to explain to you all about the theory of religion by Max Weber. We all know Max Weber was a 19th century sociologist and one of the founders of modern sociology. He gave a completely different approach, completely different from Marx and Durkheim. His approach, which was known as the interpretative approach. Now, in this approach, he tried to put the individual first. Instead of focusing on the society, he paid a lot of emphasis on the individual's action and the effect it has on a society. So, which was known as the interpretive approach. Now, Max Weber, the pioneers of the discipline of sociology and also one of the founders, of interpretive, he bridged the gap between positivism and idealism. Now, the Protestant ethic and the spirit of capitalism, was widely known for its use of the scientific methods in sociology because he tried to study the macro phenomena, that is capitalism, through the micro analysis of the individual's actions, which led to this social change, what he tried to study. Now, work, that is the Protestant Ethic and the Spirit of Capitalism, it was first published in German, later on was translated by Talcott Parsons in English. This book is a culmination of the political, economic and the religious factor which led to the rise of capitalism. A beautiful work, one of the mainstay of sociological studies. He tried to tell how Protestantism was one religion, why it led to the growth of capitalism, the factors, how the values of this particular religion encouraged the individuals to behave in a particular way. Their social actions led to the growth of capitalism is what he tried to explain in this. He merged economics. It was a culmination of political, religious factors where he did a thorough study in this particular study. Now, when you compare to Durkheim and Marx, the Weber's approach to religion is completely different. Durkheim and Marx did not study other religions. They presented religion in a different view. Max Weber's approach to religion was a completely different. He did a massive study of religions worldwide. No scholar had never undertaken such a massive study of religions worldwide because he concentrated on the world religions. When he said world religions, he wanted to know the world religion, those religions which attracted, lakhs and lakhs of believers and how it affected the global history. So he did detailed studies of Hinduism, Buddhism, Taoism and ancient Judaism, and he does talk a lot about it in his work, The Protestant Ethic and the Spirit of Capitalism, where how he says that the impact of Christianity, how it led to the growth of capitalism and why is that the other religion did not allow the growth of capitalism. He gives a very in-depth study to this. And not only that one, Weber's writing on religion concentrates. Now, when Weber is talking, when talks about a religion, he concentrates on the connection between the religion and the social change. How he says that, because religion is a universal institution and it has strong, deeply rooted values. Now, even you see in our country, whenever they want to bring about a social change in the aspect of religion, it is not taken up very well. There's a lot of voices who voice out their opinions because religion is something it is very, very dear. People are very sensitive to it. And this is also this is why one of the reasons why he tried to study, he tried to bring about, he said that religion is we all say religion is a very conservative, but he argues, he says that not necessarily, because when he did the study, he says not necessarily it has to be conservative force, because on the contrary, he says the religion inspires movements and has always in fact produced many social transformations, where he gives the example of capitalism, which happened because of Protestantism. I gave you a mention in my previous slide, how I said Weber did, no scholar had in-depth analysis of the different religions. He did immense work on these religions and did in fact publish a lot of books on the different. So he had a wide knowledge of all the major religions. Now, in the Protestant Ethic and the Spirit of Capitalism, Weber examined the impact of Christianity. He saw that, like, you know, in Christianity, in Protestantism, he saw the roots of the capitalism because of this particular religion and because of the particular values. He examines, like, you know, the fundamental purpose, like, you know, what he wanted to find out was, his fundamental purpose of Weber was to research, was to discover how this particular religion had an impact on the social change which took place in Europe. Now, in the, and he said that it's not that the non-Western civilizations, like the, neither were the backward. It is just that they did not accept the values as compared to the way the Protestantism accepted the values, and which, and it dominated Europe. And it is one of the reasons why also we could see the growth of capitalism over there. And he spoke a lot about India and China. And in fact, he called Hinduism the other worldly religion. He did in-depth analysis of this one. Now, this is the picture of the Confucianism. Like, there's the three religions that dominated China. That is, one is Confucianism and Taoism and Buddhism. Now, when he said about what is that, we all know that China was already, it was a place like, you know, where the economy was good and they were very, very culturally, like, you know, they had a very strong cultural thing. One of the reasons why you could not see the growth of this particular capitalism in the religion of China, he says that it is because of this Confucius ethics. It did not permit the rise of capitalism because it laid a lot of focus on ideas like, you know, based upon collective harmony, traditionalism and family obligation. And in fact, they laid a lot of stress on, like, you know, nature. Confucianism, like, you know, they in fact acted against eco-development. They emphasized that you need to have a harmony in the world. China for a long time was very powerful and culturally the most developing civilization in the world, but the dominant religious values in fact acted as a break to economic development, because like how I said, they laid a lot of emphasis to, like, you know, nature. This is what he tried to bring about, the interrelationship between economy and religion, because religion is all about a set of ideas and beliefs about the supernatural which really impacts the life of the human being. Economics is what about, like, you know, it is all about the society needs to provide the basic needs, necessities. It's all about production, consumption and distribution. So this religion, he says, prescribes certain, like, you know, guidelines of behavior. So this is where he says in, like, you know, Confucianism is played, because they played so much of emphasis, like, you know, and even Taoism, like how I said, Taoism also, they believed a lot in, like, you know, harmony with the nature. They said that excessive use of nature will bring disaster and extinction of human beings. Buddhism, yes, of course, they were so much against. They said, they always said that to find happiness, we need to let go the materialistic thing. So now, capitalism is all about materialistic. So you see, like, you know, so these three religions were, like, in the principles that, what were the important principles they laid focus on? Simple life, they should be guardians of nature and humanity. So this is where he says that you could not see the rise of capitalism in China. The same way, even when he spoke about Hinduism in the same way. Like, you know, like, this is, I think this is, I've explained to you all everything. Religion concerns beyond the thing. Economy deals with the business, because all about ideas, because these are the things that, you know, that plays as the main guide, because my religion does not allow me to do it, so I will not do it. So these guidelines are incorporated in the body of religious ethics of each religious system, so each person does not want to go beyond this. Like how I said, Hinduism also, he said that he had a lot of respect for Hinduism, which he called as the worldly religion. At the same time, the ideas of the karma, dharma and the punarjarma, all these things prevented the rise of capitalism. In India, like, you know, if you look at the main beliefs of the Hinduism, it is moksha. That is, the goal of an individual is to release from the cycle of death and rebirth. And how does it happen? It is when the soul unites with the the Brahman by realizing the true nature. The paths lead, all these paths of, you know, moksha leads us to realization, that is, plus truth is the path of the, like, you know, the path of knowledge, the path of duty, and the path of devotion, where you have surrender, unconditional surrender to God, is when you attain your moksha. So when you have all these principles, there is no scope for economic development, because here you are surrendering everything towards God. You are in the search of truth, everything. This is what Weber had to say. He said that apart from that one, he said in India, to, like, you know, the substance was there, but the spirit was absent. This is what he said. And apart from that, there were many structural barriers that was there in the form of caste systems, spiritual barriers, and in the form of ideas like karma and punarjarma. This is the analysis he said that. So, if you look at the igloo material, this is what they say, like, you know, and we all know that in India, the beef ban, it's one of the become a political issues, culminated with religious ideas. A health expert might suggest that if Indians could eat beef, the problem of hunger and malnutrition might be lessened, because it is a poor man's protein food. Now this is what a health expert says, but what does the value of our religion say? You're not supposed to eat beef because cow is supposed to be a sacred animal. So here, this is what the link I'm trying to bring up over here, as suggested in the igloo thing, because many a time this is a very sensitive issue. People do not take it in the right sense, like, so this is not my idea, this is what I put forth, it's been quoted in the igloo textbook. So here, this idea of the very fact that the sacred definitely goes much higher than what the health expert says, because it is the values or the beliefs my religion says and I need to believe. This is the link what Max Weber wanted to bring about, the religious beliefs and the economic behavior of, like, you know, how it either stalls some changes or it can give rise to a change. So he said religions like, why religions like Hinduism, Confucianism, Taoism did not allow capitalism? Because they had their ideas put a brake to economic development, whereas Protestantism is something, because of the values, it led to the growth of capitalism. So this is the end of my lesson. In my next lesson, I will try and explain to you all how the values of this Protestantism gave rise, how it changed the individual ideas and which led to the growth of capitalism in Europe. So once again, happy Teacher's Day. And I, as a teacher, will try my best to do my duty towards the students, imparting knowledge, guiding you all, and acting as a mentor. Great pleasure teaching you guys. I'll see you on my next lesson, that is the Protestant Ethic and the Spirit of